Thank you, and great to be with TEDx. Mon said that here are the talkers, the diplomats, and there are the doers. I mean, TED is a good example, I think, of the fact that even talkers can have an impact. And if you look at global history, of course, some of the greatest changes that have occurred in human history have been brought by talkers and thinkers, but they must line up with the doers. And I hope that that is what has been going on today. When we talk about digital issues and diplomacy and whatever, talking and thinking, it's essentially, of course, about communications, about human minds getting together, sharing information, and then, as we all do, when we get somewhat better informed, that changes the way in which we think, in which we act, and the things that we do. And thus, diplomacy, communication of different sorts, is about changing behavior. It is about informing, creating better opportunities, opening up possibilities that might not have been there before. Whether this is going to save the world immediately is a somewhat more debatable prospect, I agree, but at least it does change things. And I think all of you here are acutely aware of the fact that the internet is a revolutionary thing. It is a technology that is truly transformative in a way that we haven't seen for a very long time indeed. We all have these numbers that we can present on the rapid speed of connectivity and whatever. And I think the number that I normally use, which I find fascinating, is the enormous increase in mobile connectivity. And not just normal mobiles, but mobile broadband, which is the net through the air coming to all over the world. And on present trends, within 5 years, we're going to have 2/3 of the population of the world that can be reached or that can reach mobile connectivity with a broadband connectivity bandwidth that is greater than is accessible in most of Europe today. What will this mean in terms of transformative potentials for the different countries around the world? Quite a lot, I would argue. And of course, we see that already in X numbers of different areas. You see the, obviously, the economic impact of what the net has meant. Not only the entrepreneurs that have created things that are sort of making their companies grow, but things like the World Bank are trying to assess now and then, what does it mean in terms of the potential for developing countries to lift themselves out of poverty to the new potential that comes with it. And they've been calculating that if you increase the broadband connectivity by roughly 10%, or the broadband coverage in a given country, you increase the economic growth potential by roughly 1% a year. That's a huge amount of money. That means that it's probably the biggest tool for development of poorer countries that we've been seeing in recent human history. And some of the effects that we've seen of that have been truly mind-boggling, not only India or China, but what we see now with the fast rising billions of people of Africa does demonstrate that. The economic potential is, of course, fairly obvious. Then, of course, there's a political element to it. And that political element has been very much in focus during the last few years. Some people like it, some people distinctly dislike it. Because you can argue, simplify things somewhat, as we do sometimes, that we see a battle between the networks and the hierarchies. And I would argue that so far the networks are winning. The hierarchies are in a losing situation versus the networks. And the networks could be local or family or regional, or to a very large extent, the network could also be global. Doesn't necessarily mean that everyone in the world is connected on every single issue. But you can reach out to individuals that are engaged all over the world at the same time on any given issue. And that, of course, gives power and potential that wasn't there. I think this is something that is very good for free societies and for the values of freedom all over the world. That does not mean that we don't have rather challenging issues to deal with also in our open and free societies. The net is a reflection of society. And we are struggling within our different societies, all of the issues of security and intelligence has been quite a lot in the focus, security, terrorism, child pornography, hate speech and whatever. And these are difficult issues. But these are issues that we can deal with in free and democratic societies by laws and by transparency and by democratic debate. We've dealt with them in the sort of the offline world, and we are now dealing with them in the online world. Then, of course, speaking about the issues of the freedom on the net and the freedom off the net, we have the regimes that have a somewhat different agenda, to put it in somewhat unusually diplomatic terms for coming from me, that want to restrict the freedom on the net as much as they can, as they are restricting the freedom off the net, by the way, same thing, and then trying to control the development of the net itself, which I think is going to be one of the big issues upcoming in the years to come. The net has been developing in a way that is ungoverned, but governed by itself, and it's worked tremendously well. If you put a straitjacket on the net, I think you get not only economic negative effects, you also get into new political situation that I don't think we necessarily want to see. That's why the issues of the freedom on the net and the freedom off the net are going to be, I think, increasingly important in the years to come. The issue that's been on the agenda here today during the discussions have been, which I've fortunately not been able to attend, other things needs to be done as well, sorry to say, has then been digital diplomacy. And what is diplomacy all about? I'm foreign minister, I'm supposed to know. I'm not quite certain I do. I'm a politician from the beginning. But diplomacy is really about sort of communication between nations, nation states. That's a sort of original diplomacy. But of course, nowadays we talk quite a lot about public diplomacy. We live, thanks God, in a much more open world, in open societies, in a world where there is much more of open governance, where the voice of individual people or collectives of individual people means much more than used to be the case in the past. And thus, public diplomacy and diplomacy in the digital age, digital diplomacy, is becoming more important. It's about getting to the pulse of what's happening. If I see it from my own perspective, what use do we have of digital diplomacy? Well, diplomacy is dependent quite a lot on gathering of information. And I would say getting the pulse of the world, getting the pulse of events. And I can see that in my own daily work today. Dramatic development in the Rada, the parliament of Ukraine, when suddenly the regime there introduces seven new laws, some of them fairly draconian, in limiting freedom in different respects, including the freedom of the net, and having them all voted in 10 minutes without any debates. Where do you get the fastest information? You get it on the net, because you saw then the Twitter accounts starting to explode on those particular issues. So far, that's possible. You get the pulse of what's happening. We can see the reactions or the information on the referendum that has happened in Egypt during the last 2 days on a constitution. A referendum where I understand that 98%, oh, impressive, I'm surprised it wasn't 100, approved the new constitution of a regime that perhaps has an agenda that we could take issue with on certain respects. There you get the feelings. Or the tragedies that we see, be that the suffering in Syria, which has been, I think, the first civil war that we've seen on Skype and Bambuser and Twitter and wherever. There's been a lot of evil in the world for a very long time, and we've seen civil wars that have been even worse than what we've seen in Syria now. We had 15 years in Lebanon, we had 10 years in Algeria, but this is the first civil war that reaches us through the social media. Even if you see the tragedy of what's happening in South Sudan during the last just few weeks, since mid-December, probably not one of the most well-connected societies and economies of the world, if I might just take a guess. But there you've been able to follow not only sort of military development, but the reactions of people and the humanitarian tragedy on the social media, be that the one or the other. That's just examples of getting the pulse of crisis situation, and then you can get a pulse on quite a number of different other things. That's obviously important. In a world of hyperconnectivity, we are connected to what is happening in a way that was not possible before. And then, of course, diplomacy being diplomacy, public diplomacy being public diplomacy, we have an interest in not only listening to what's happening in the world, but also getting people to listen to us, needless to say. Get the message out. Of course, going back to the concept of diplomacy, there's still secret diplomacy. There's still conventional diplomacy. There's the necessity for governments and authorities on sensitive issues to be able to communicate confidentially. Sometimes because they want to safeguard true secrets. There are true secrets, not too many, but there are those. Sometimes and quite often because you want to protect individuals. Sometimes you talk about individuals that are in exposed positions, and you don't want to expose them even more than it's already the case. So secret diplomacy and close diplomacy still have a substantial role to play. But increasingly, in a world of open governance, we need to reach out with the positions that we have. And we want to reach out, of course, because we want to have our position in order to influence the behavior of governments. And to influence the behavior of governments and states, it can also be important to influence the behavior and the attitudes of individuals. And here, social, the new media, or the new possibilities of the different social media, are, of course, tremendously important in different respects. And what we are now seeing is that the one diplomatic service after the other around the world is taking the first steps in order to use these different means. That's not something, it's revolutionary in terms of the technology, but not necessarily in terms of the effort to reach out. We've seen the importance of radio and broadcasting, the role of the BBC during the Second World War in Europe is not to be underestimated. But now we take a new leap in terms of the technological possibilities. And then the third use, which I think is important from a diplomatic point of view, is to inform what we are doing. Governments have a duty to inform what they are doing. Diplomacy is surrounded sometimes, and diplomats, with an element of mystery. What are they really doing? And here we have a way of communicating to wider public what we are doing, or at least trying to do, to inform about our countries, our activities, and also to be able to reach people in emergency situation. There could certainly be an earthquake, there could be a catastrophe, there could be war, to give information out to individuals much faster than would otherwise have been the case. I think digital, there was a talk about this being sort of diplomacy 3.0. Well, remains to be seen. But I think it is the start of something new. There have been one day of discussing digital diplomacy in Stockholm. There's going to be another day tomorrow to produce conclusions. And produce conclusions on something that we really started to think about, well, 6 months, 12 months, perhaps 18 months ago. We are at the very, very early stages of something. Is it going to transform everything? No, it's not. Is it going to replace all diplomacy in the world? No, it's not. But it is going to fundamentally transform the way in which we do public diplomacy, interaction between governments, interaction between governments and people, and interactions between people all across the world. Yes, I think that will happen. It might not save the world. That's rather ambitious. But I think it will increase our possibilities to work together for a better world. And that is not a small thing in itself. Thank you.